This is about the pathology of musculoskeletal system. So under this system, the pathological changes or the disease condition of this system, I mean musculoskeletal system, will be briefly discussed. The first one is about a very important this disease condition of the muscles that is known as equine rhabdomyolysis or equine myoglobinuria. Okay, and this is very much important so far your exam is concerned. And this condition is also commonly known as azuturia or Monday morning disease. Okay, the name is very typical, as you know, this Monday morning disease or Monday morning sickness. Okay, so that is because of the condition is all of you might have experienced that during the games and sports, like suddenly without any warm up and all the thing, you go to the this field and they start playing. Okay, and the whole day, I mean, you play. Then the this next day, I mean, you take this good amount of this food, then take rest, and the next morning, for example, or this on Saturday, for example, you have the display, and that the whole this Sunday is also this you didn't go to any games and sports, and I'll take rest, taking good amount of this food and all. Then this next day you will feel that very much painful and stiffness of your legs, right? And very much painful, right? And that condition, so that condition is the one, what happened in this this equine rhabdomyolysis. Of course, this is a very common condition of this muscular disease in case of these equines, and commonly known as equine azuturia. And in this case, what happened is that normally means there used to be accumulation of this lactic acid in the muscles. Okay, because of that, there will be high glycogen storage, and this kind of this accumulation of this lactic acid in the muscles and deposition of this glycogen and this store high glycogen glycogen and all, it leads to contraction of the muscle. That's why there will be lack of oxygen supply when the muscle fibers muscles are contracted. Okay, the blood vessels and all this, that will also be contracted, and the blood supply, this oxygen supply through this blood and vessels and on through the blood which used to come along with the, right? So that will not be there in that very particular area. So that will give a very painful condition and very much stiffness condition. And in this condition, because of the lack of this oxygen supply to this particular this part of the this body, like gluteal muscles or the heavy, where the heavy muscles are there. So this myelinized, this muscle fibers, the myocytes, they used to undergo necrosis, this lactic this effect, because of the absence of this oxygen and this nutrients and all, they will die. So muscle necrosis will be there. So after the lysis of these muscles, there will be release of the muscle and these enzymes known as this myoglobin. Okay, this enzyme used to be released from the necrotic and this lysis disperse, and this in high this amount when it is released from these muscles and all, so that used to be excreted to the urine. That's why it is known as myoglobinuria. Okay, and the urine used to give a very dark red color, deep red, this dark red color in those urines, right? And after walking some these steps, the animal will feel, means I'm now talking about in case of these horses. So suddenly it means they will stop walking. Okay. And after walking a few steps and all, they will be unable to move further. And even they will be feel very much painful with intense sweating from that this very particular this part of the body, like gluteal muscles, heavy these muscles are there. And the muscles of the this animal, the horse, or particularly the loins and the quarters, where the heavy muscles are there. So they will become very much hardened, resulting in cramping, this muscle cramps, as you know, and muscular stiffness when they went for exercise. Okay, and the horse stride, that is when they are taking long steps, it will become shorter. Normally they used to take just long steps, but it will become shorter, and it will stay there behind, and then goes lame and may collapse. Even walk is continued. Means if they go on doing exercise or walking and all these things, so they may go on staggering and this incoordination and imbalance type of this movement, and they may lie down, this is showing like at the limb, and they may even collapse. Okay, and when you examine the particularly the hindquarters, so they used to show very much stiffening. And in very severe at this cases, as I have told you, that muscle necrosis used to be there from those damaged muscles, and all the enzyme, this myoglobin, used to be released through the urine. So the urine will get very dark red in color. Okay, and this used to occur in well-fed horses after a gap of holiday. Means, for example, on Saturday, you have, this utilize the, the for walking purposes or exercises, your race and all these things. Then the, this Sunday means they took this good amount of this this food, and they took red pull and this race. Then on Monday, if you put on this work or this exercise and all, so they will show this kind of this and this disease condition or this problem. And when the myoglobin used to be released from the muscles, the damaged muscles, and that will go through the urine, so the urine will show this very much dark red in color. That is due to the presence of this myoglobin, what we call this myoglobin urea. That's why it is known as equine myoglobin urea. And where myelolysis used to be there, of course, and that's why equine rhabdomyolysis, and means it is also known as azoturia. And normally it happens after a gap of this holiday, like this Saturday, Sunday, then on Monday. So Monday morning sickness or disease, right? And these are some of the pictures of the affected horses, like this, the muscle, this used to be very much cramping, and the stiffness and hurting, like both, like this hurting will be there, and sweating will be there. And if the, this animal, even sometimes it may die. When excessive amount of this myoglobin used to be this retained, and a high amount of this, this myoglobin in the this urinary system, particularly in kidney, means damage of the kidney, kidney failure may be there, it may also die. So if you collect the kidney in such cases, then particularly from the urinary bladder or from the renal pelvis and all this, if you collect the urine or from those affected animal when they are passing the urine and all, if you collect, it will give just like a coffee color, like a very dark red in color and this urine. Okay, so this is what I have explained, how it happens. What is the mechanism of this disease azoturia? That means, as I have already mentioned, that the animal should be at rest with well food, and when the muscles used to well store with this deposition of this glycogen, and when suddenly they put on this work, and glycogen used to be converted into lactic acid, and that used to be accumulated in the muscles, and large amount of this lactic acid, okay, they will stimulate extreme contraction of the muscles. So the muscles becomes very hard, just like board, like this hardness would be there. And in this very this condition of the contracted state of the muscles, the circulation, blood circulation used to be very less and very poor. So oxygen supply used to be reduced. And under this hypoxic condition, means less oxygen supply, more and more lactic acid used to be formed from the pyruvic acid. Okay, means glycogen into pyruvic acid, then to lactic acid. So this conversion and will be more, and still further contraction of the muscle will go on, and greater containment of the blood flow will be there in that very particular area, leading to greater reduction of oxygen supply. Then the muscles in that very particular area will not get proper or sufficient amount of this oxygen as well as the nutrition. So the muscles will undergo necrosis, and from this damage or necrosis myocytes or muscle fibers, the enzyme myoglobin used to be liberated or released, and that will be excreted through the urine, right? So when this kind of this condition is, I was talking about, I mean, this very much, I mean, this large amount of this myoglobin used to be retained and this accumulated and all. So that may lead to even this damage of the kidney, permanent damage of the kidney. So the animal may die in such conditions if it goes on, right? Then next is white muscle disease, or known as stiff limb disease. So here, what happened is that the name is a white muscle turns into whitish in color. Okay, so this is nothing but due to the extensive coagulative necrosis of the muscles, which used to be found in calves, due to the deficiency of vitamin E, particularly during the 6 months of this age. Okay, means it is mainly due to the vitamin E along with selenium deficiency, or sometimes under the stress condition. So in such cases, the animal used to show in three different classical forms. One is stiff type, second is respiratory type, and the third one is cardiac form. So the changes, the gross changes used to be the color of the muscles become very much pale pink, yellowish red or gray or even white. That's why white muscle disease, as I'm showing here. Normal muscle fiber, then I mean, as here normal muscle fiber pinkies and all, then it turns into very less pink or gray or like I mean, this whitish in nature, right? Then the muscles become very much dry, inelastic as well as firm. Okay, means it will not remain the normal, I mean, this moisture condition of the muscle elasticity, and even it turns into firmness. And in this case also, there used to be necrosis, coagulative type of this necrotic muscles. That's why here also there used to be release of the enzyme myoglobin. So the urine used to turn, gives a brownish or red or chocolate brown color. Okay. So as I'm showing here, and this about the, and this white muscle disease. Then next is muscle atrophy, atrophic condition of the muscles. Mostly as in case of this all age condition, what we call this senility or disuse, when you are not using your muscles for this long period and all this, or under starvation, or atrophy of the wasting disease. Okay, like as in case of your TB, tuberculosis, like then cachexic condition, then malnutrition, denervation, or even this pressure, like if you are using some rubber band, like or this white and this rubber band or some other bands in your wrist, in your hand, right? For long period, like, then in that very particular area, the muscle will be showing atrophic condition. Okay. And some pressure is given by that band, or and this even some denervation may occur, like, or and due to cut, like, I mean, this injury and all these things. So the nerve supply to that very particular part of the muscle, I mean, this body, I mean, maybe dynapated, like, or when you are not proper taking and this food, and that means you are not using that very particular area, or, I mean, this in disease conditions, like, I mean, this tuberculosis, wasting disease, then disease health, and this health, ill health condition, cachexia, then malnutrition, or even when you are getting old, like as in all aged people, like senility. So in all these conditions, muscles used to be atrophied. Okay, reduction in the size of the muscle fiber, and as a whole, that body part, I mean, this used to be reduced in size. So grossly, if you see that the muscle loses its normal pink color, it may turn into paleness, gray, or even brown in color. Then it will become firmer due to replacement by fibrous connective tissue, and there may be disfigurement due to uneven atrophy of the different muscles. Okay, and in such conditions, when the muscles are atrophied and losing your muscles and all this, and then automatically the skeletal used to become very much prominent. Okay, and if you see, I'm just microscopically in such conditions, and one very and this common and this condition, and you might have, I don't know, I mean, heard about this brown atrophy or wear and tear pigments. Okay, these are nothing but when the fragmented muscles or the muscles affected in these conditions. Okay, and there may be deposition of this wear and tear pigment at the poles of the nuclei of those muscle fibers, giving a brownish color when these muscles are undergoing atrophic conditions. Okay, so this condition is known as or commonly termed as brown atrophy. Okay, then next is about the inflammation of these muscles, that is myositis. So it may be this different types, acute or chronic. So first one, acute myositis, that means acute inflammation of the skeletal muscles. Okay, so maybe this different type, this inflammatory reaction according to different etiological agents and the different exudate form, maybe this serous, prevenous, hemorrhagic and all these things, right? So that's why different this change is also a characteristic feature, maybe they're according to different etiological agents as well as the exudates, this form in that very particular area, right? So mainly caused due to traumatic injuries, like cut injuries, or this bullet, and then bullet injury, or like this cut injuries by sharp objects like knives and all these things, then vitamin E or selenium deficiencies, or in case of this infectious agents by like Clostridium sauvoi. And we learn some particular disease of this Clostridium infections like black quarter or black leg in case of this cattle, where you'll find this hemorrhagic myositis, okay, which turns into deep red and blackening of the affected muscles and all those things we learn in details in this disease, black quarter or black leg. Okay, and if you see the affected muscles in such conditions, acute condition of the inflammatory condition of this skeletal muscles, so muscles used to be very much extremely moist, and the color becomes very much red, and the consistency used to be very firm and dense, and there may be swelling and accumulation of gases in between the muscle fibers. So there may be some kind of this crepitating sound on palpation when you just palpate in that very particular area. So in between the muscle fiber there is formation of gas bubbles and all, so you will feel crepitating sound in this very particular area. Okay, then this very particular muscle turns into red or black with the gases form in between the this muscle fibers with the inflammatory exudates. Okay, and if it is of mainly this Clostridium infections and all, these are gram-positive rod-shaped organisms, right? So you can detect when you collect this inflammatory exudate, the fluid from that very particular muscle, this affected area and all, if you collect the fluid and all, then if you smear it and stain with gram stain, and then you will find or you can demonstrate the presence of this gram-positive rods in that, those this particularly Clostridium organisms, right? So these are some of the these pictures. Yes, I am talking about the acute myositis, so it may be of hemorrhagic type, and this very severe hemorrhagic lesions, right? And moist of the extremely moist condition of the muscles used to be there, and even it may turn into black in color, as in case of this black quarter, as I was talking about. Okay, like this. Okay, and if you make the sections also, means you can demonstrate the presence of this gram-positive organisms in between the muscle fibers. Then next is hemorrhagic myositis. So in this condition, the inflammatory condition is with the inflammatory exudate with hemorrhagic exudate, this blood exudates. Okay, so mostly in case of the these traumatic injuries or Clostridium infections, when the muscle fibers used to be severely affected, showing the inflammatory reaction with severation of the severance of the blood vessels. So blood used to be coming out in that very particular area. So the inflammatory exudate used to be of just mixed with blood. So it is of this hemorrhagic type of myositis. And the area becomes very red or cyanotic in color. Then if you cut the this particular this inflamed area, large amount of this blood used to be coming out from the muscles, and if you touch it, the affected area used to be very much firm and painful, and the regional lymph nodes along with that, just nearby that very particular and this muscle, and this showing hemorrhagic myositis. So those regional lymph nodes used to be very much enlarged and swollen. Okay. So these are some of the this picture showing hemorrhagic myositis like this. Okay, and if you make the sections, you'll find so many these RBCs. Okay, this present in the in between the muscle fibers and all, along with the this exudate and all, right? Then chronic myositis in the chronic inflammatory condition of the muscles. So this is nothing but chronic inflammatory condition of the muscles where you may have necrotic changes with calcification and a proliferation of the fibrous connective tissue. One thing always means you should remember is that in any case of the chronic inflammatory reaction of any part, any tissue, so normally means exudation used to be very less. Okay, and the muscle, the cells, the parenchymatous cells of that very particular organ or the tissue and all. So normally means the hallmark, the main thing that changes used to be always replacement of the parenchymatous cell by the fibrous connective tissue cell. Right, so that's why here also the muscle fibers used to be this replaced by fibrous connective tissue. So in case of this disease like tuberculosis and pseudotuberculosis, there used to be multiple focal nodular lesions containing caseation and fibrous capsule. I mean this inside the central part caseous necrotic area used to be there, and the surrounding means you may find that this kind of this nodular lesion used to be very hard and firm due to fibrous connective this capsule and this covering. Okay, so it may be this chronic myositis may be due to Mycobacterium tuberculosis infection, Corynebacterium pseudotuberculosis causing pseudotuberculosis, then Trichinella species infection or Sarcosporidia this infections, then Tinea this infections and all. Okay, so like that means in the muscles, the affected muscles may be showing very much hard and firm. Even this calcium salt deposition may also be there, as I'm showing here. This grayish white, these points, these are the calcified areas and hardening and the nodular lesions, as I'm showing here, like this. Okay, so in all this, if you go for the gross changes, if you see that the muscles used to become very hard to touch. Nodules, as I'm showing here, see nodular lesions, and on cut section, particularly this kind of just nodular lesions where the this muscle chronic and is showing this inflammatory reaction, then there will be central caseative necrotic area, and outer covering used to be very much hard due to fibrous covering capsule, and sometimes there may be calcium salt depositions in those areas. Okay. Then, now coming to pathology of the skeletal system. Those are the common pathological condition of the muscle, muscular system, now skeletal system. So there are some developmental anomalies under this skeletal system, like abrachia, that means absence of anterior limbs, amelia, absence of the limbs, all limbs, apodia, absence of the posterior limbs, micromalia, that means small size limbs, and adductilism, absence of all the toes in a limb. Okay, then brachydactylism, that means abnormal shortening of the toes. Then polydactylism, more number of digits. Okay, as in case of like horses and pigs, you may come across. Then next is lordosis. That means curvature of the spine with a ventral convexity. Means the this spine cord. This vertebra and of then spine cord used to be there. When they are showing ventral convexity towards the ventral portion, like it is curved down, like so. Then that condition of the I'm this spine, when it is showing different curvature, particularly down the ventral side. Okay, that is known as lordosis, I'll show you. Then kyphosis, abnormal curvature of or dorsal prominence of the spine, commonly known as humpback, the this back portion of the animal, like for example, it will show abnormal curvature towards the this dorsal upside. Okay, so it will become very much prominent, particularly this back area and all. Okay, lumbar and this back area and all. So that's why it is known as humpback. Then next is scoliosis, that is abnormal lateral curvature of spinal column. When the spinal column is showing curvature towards the lateral side, left or right, and this side, not ventral or not dorsal. Okay, means ventrally lordosis, then dorsally kyphosis. So if it is not that way, so lateral side, on the left side or right side, any side, so this kind of this abnormal lateral curvature of the spinal cord, that is called scoliosis. Then torticollis, this torticollis, you might have heard about right neck. I don't know, means you might have heard or not. Sometimes, people, just even this position during the night and the sleep and all this thing, when you're sleeping during nighttime, then your neck was this position, and on next day morning when you get up, then you'll find that your neck is twisted. Okay, means that kind of this neck is known as wry neck. Okay, twisting of the neck with an unnatural position of head. So that is known as torticollis. Okay, wry neck. So these are some of the pictures showing this one, polydactyly. This the polydactyly means more number of digits, these digits more than the normal numbers. Okay, then here again, one of the very important and this common, this disease condition of the, skeletal system, particularly in case of this, this horses, equine families, equines. And this is another important, so far your examination is concerned, in the form of like the short notes and all this, right? That is fibrous osteodystrophy or osteodystrophia fibrosa. And the synonyms are big head disease, Brown disease, or Miller's disease. Okay, so I will just explain you why they are giving this kind of this. This pathologically, this is nothing but fibrous osteodystrophy or osteodystrophia fibrosa, and commonly known as the synonyms like big head, Brown disease, and Miller's disease and all. What happened is that particularly in case of the this equines, the people who are having, their own this rice mill, for example, wheat mill or this rice mill and all. And there used to be abundant, they used to have abundant of brands, rice bran or wheat bran and all these things. And they used to mostly feed the ration containing more amount of these brands. Okay. And this bran and this excessive feeding of this bran, rice bran or the wheat bran and all. So in such conditions, what happened is that there has to be change in the, there has to be, this imbalance in the phosphorus and this calcium ratio. Okay, calcium used to be more, this less, and phosphorus used to be more, because the rice bran used to contain more phosphorus. And this kind of this imbalance in the ratio of the calcium and phosphorus, the normally means it should be of 2:1. But in this condition, when you are giving and feeding excessive amount of this bran, so it will be 1:3 instead of 2:1, the calcium and phosphorus ratio. That means excess of this phosphorus with less calcium. And other than this, there may be, factors or the causative, this agents or factors like how this hyperparathyroidism, then vitamin D deficiency, or even when you are giving less this calcium but excess phosphorus and dietary deficiency of this calcium, right? So in all these conditions and all, what happens is that so Here, it is due to the excessive action of this parathyroid hormone on the bones. So the bone resorption with replacement of fibrous connective tissue occurs, leading to increased osteoid formation, which doesn't get sufficient mineral for deposition and formation of cysts used to be there, right? So that's why the bone used to be fibrous in nature. It is not hard as a normal undisc bone. The undisc hardness of the bone will not be there. So incest conditions usually occurs after the prolonged diet consisting largely of this grain or like the corn or the this grain byproducts like your and this bran, rice bran or wheat bran and all these things. So because of that, I mean this, it has been given as bran disease. And particularly, I mean incest conditions, you know, I mean this, the skeletal mass, bones of the head, particularly face area and all these things, that used to be very much affected and they used to be very much swollen, like the swelling of the jaws. Initially, and it may be sharp and becoming this harder later, and this fibrous connective tissue may be this accumulating, and it may turn into hardness and all this. Initially, sharp like. So that's why the head of the affected animal used to be just very much enlarged and very much big. It becomes right. So that's why big head or big head condition, right? And the rubber and the jaws used to become rubbery in nature. So that's why rubbery jaw used to be there, right? So these are some of the these points to be noted on. So for your examination is also concerned and very important. And if you see the affected animals, as I have told already, the facial at these bones, like the head area, and the, so mostly these bones used to be very much soft and flexible and deformed and much enlarged. And the head as a whole used to become very much big due to the involvement of all these facial bones, which used to be enlarged and swollen. Okay, and in such condition, there used to be reabsorption of the calcium from the bone, and fibrous connective tissue used to replace the bony tissues, and all. So it become fibrous in nature, like, and there will be just lack of calcification in such of case of this affected bones like this. Okay. And this is microscopic measure. If you make the section and all, then means all the this bony tissue used to be replaced by fibrous connective tissue, showing these hyperplastic changes, and there will be enlargement of the Haversian canals. Okay, these Haversian canals used to be much enlarged, and the bony tissue used to be replaced by this fibroblasts with osteoclastic giant cells lining the remaining bone tissues. The osteoclastic giant cells, these are the these cells, I mean, would used to remove the this bone fragments and all these things, right? Okay. Then next is about rickets. This is another important, as my heart, all of you, I mean, and you might have seen some of these cases also, like in humans or sometimes in animals also having this rickets. Okay. So it is nothing but it is the inadequate deposition of this calcium in the bones of the growing animals as well as even in humans. Mostly it used to occur due to the deficiency of this calcium and vitamin D. And in such conditions, the main characteristic feature when you see the affected animals as well as the human also, like the growing children and the growing these animals, there used to be bending of the limbs, bow leg condition like this. Okay, like this bow leg, it is known as bending of the legs, and enlargement of the ends of the long bones at the ends like this. The end used to be enlarged. Okay, long bone ends used to be much enlarged, and as a whole there used to be skeletal deformity, means the skeletal and this bone, I mean this used to be deformed. So as I have already mentioned, vitamin D deficiency is one of the main and this cause. And under the deficiency condition of the vitamin D, the absorption of the calcium as well as the phosphorus used to be deficient, cannot be taken up. So that's why automatically it will be deficient, right? And grossly, if you see that affected animals or the growing children, they will show this kind of this bow leg condition because of this bending of the legs. And the pot belly appearance, the belly portion used to hang down, pot belly. And the enlarged costochondral junction, that is the articulation, particularly in case of the avian species in birds, commonly known as rickettsial rosary. I mean, all the this costochondral junction, when you see the ribs, you know, I'm just joining with the, I mean, this xiphoid cartilage and all this, in that junction, costochondral articulation or the junction. So that used to be enlarged. So give like a very typical this appearance that there used to be so many knots in any string, like, so that is commonly known as rickettsial rosary. So it normally happens in case of this avian species, like in this poultry parts and all. And such kind of this affected bones used to be very much soft in nature. Opening of the bones used to be there due to less deposition of this calcium. The Britain and these are already the hardness of the bone will not be there. So this is the one as I was talking about in case of this poultry parts. The ribs, you know, and these are the ribs. Then the joining, the costochondral junction or the articulation where it just connects to the one is with the spinal cord and this vertebra and this vertebra, then down there in the this xiphoid cartilage and all. So this kind of this joint and this part, that is costochondral junction or the articulation, used to be very much enlarged. Okay. So this condition in case of poultry birds, this is commonly known as rickettsial rosary, like this. Okay. So this is another, this important rickettsial rosary for definition and all these things, right? Then next is osteomalacia. This is just opposite to your, this ricket. Means ricket is mainly in case of the young growing animals as well as the children, right? I mean, where the bone deformity, bending of the bones, and the bone used to be, this very sharp due to the less this calcium deposition and all these things. But when it occurs in case of the adults, then it is known as osteomalacia. That's why it is also known as adult rickets. So it may occur in the bones of the adults due to deficiency here, also due to deficiency of vitamin D. Because of that, calcium and the phosphorus used to be this deficient, and leading to softening and bending of the bones. Okay, and here also means similarly, means there will be softening of the bones, irregular diffuse thickening of the bones may be there, and the deformity, the bone, and this may be deformed. It won't show the normal and this bony and this structure or the and this poison and all these things. Then next is osteoporosis. So it is nothing but the atrophic condition of the bones, mainly due to possibly hormonal imbalance. Okay, like, this when the hormones are this imbalance is there, then vitamin C deficiency as well as copper deficiency. These are some of the factors or the this causative agents or the factors for osteoporosis. And here, if you see the affected bones, okay, there will be inadequate deposition of the calcium, leading to brittleness of the bone, fragmentation, this breaking of the, it used to be fragile, this easily, brittleness of the bone. And there will be more porous structures in the bone. Okay, like this. This is a healthy normal bone. Here, more porous and these pores and these holes, like this, due to the inadequate deficiency of this calcium. So this kind of this bone, when it is showing this increased porosity and with very much fragile condition due to the less deposition of this calcium. Okay, so easily it is fragile or it can be broken, So that condition is known as osteoporosis, and there will be inadequate calcium deposition. The bone becomes very much brittle and porous in nature, and there will be increased fragility of the bones, means easily breakable. Okay. Then next is osteopetrosis, enlargement of the bone, means like, the towards the both sides of, and I'm this, you know, I'm this bones. Okay. This enlargement of the bones may be towards the outside or towards the this end, like in between and this inside that what you have bone marrow. Okay. So this bony tissue, so when you check it, you will find that it is very much enlarged. Enlargement towards the outside as well as inside. So thickening of this bony tissue and this structure will be there, right? And less this, bone marrow will be there. So, and this kind of this bone also used to be, very much brittle or fragile, and it may give little bit marbling nature of the bones and reduction in the bone marrow because of the thickening and this increase in the thickening of the bony this structure towards outside as well as the inside, right? And normally means in case of this avian and this avian species, due to avian mucosis virus infection, means it may be there, or sometimes due to toxic condition like fluorosis and this fluorine toxicity, fluorosis condition also may be because they have been there in that. So in such cases, what you will find is that all the cartilage of the bone always used to be calcified, and it may be surrounded by osseous tissue. Okay. Then next is osteomyelitis. So this is nothing but the inflammation of the bone along with the bone marrow. Only the bone, this if it is inflamed, that is known as osteitis. Okay. When it is along with the bone marrow, then osteomyelitis. Okay. So that is known as inflammation of this bone and bone marrow. And it may be due to traumatic injury as well as, this infectious agents, particularly of the pus-forming organism, what we call pyogenic organisms or bacterial organisms, right? And in such conditions also, there may be destruction and replacement of the bone tissue, bony tissue, with excessive growth of new bone tissue, bones adjacent to the infected part. Okay. And as I have already mentioned you that this infectious agent which may come through the this circulation, that means hematogenous infections or direct infection through the traumatic injuries, or like very commonly as in case of this fractures, when you have fracture, open fractures and all this, through that when this bacterial organisms and all these things, infection may contaminate, it may get into the this bone, right? Then some organisms like Actinomyces pyogenes, Actinomyces bovis, Staphylococcus aureus, and Pseudomonas, and all these things. These are some of the common bacterial organisms which used to be, just very commonly disinfecting the bones in such cases, like when you have the injury and fractures and all these things, right? And if you see the affected, bones in this case, so you will find, because of the pyogenic or pus-forming organism, bacterial organism infections and all, chances of formation of or development of the abscesses within the bone marrow, inside this bone marrow, abscess may be formed, and excessive growth of the bone in adjacent area, just adjacent to that very particular this part, so excessive bony growth used to be there, and there may be exostosis and endostosis. That means the enlargement may be towards the outside and even the inside. Okay, so this way means you may have exostosis and endostosis, right? Then next is pulmonary osteoarthropathy. This is a very rare case of this disease, particularly in case of this dog, sheep, cat, sometimes in horses and lion. Here means pulmonary means involvement of the lungs. Osteoarthropathy means along with the lungs, there may be involvement of some lesions in the joints. Okay, some of these disease conditions. That means when you are having the lungs problems, like because of the pneumonia, for example, some other lungs condition, you are having, for example, cough, then dyspnea, respiratory disturbances and all. So along with this, the animal may also show formation of some new bone, leading to thickening and deformity of the limbs in association with these respiratory problems, some lung lesions. Okay, So maybe due to prolonged anoxic condition, when the animal is having this less oxygen supply and for a long and time, like then sometimes due to some toxic this condition, this toxemia going into the circulation and toxemia and this and toxemic conditions and all. So if you see those animals, then automatically the animal will show respiratory problems like pneumonia maybe there. And along with these respiratory troubles and problems and all this, you will find some newborn formation just beneath the periosteum in long bones. In case of just long bones, okay, this periosteum just outside and this covering of the bony tissue. Okay, so this periosteum, just beneath that, there may be formation of some new bony structure. And proliferation of this bony structure may be very much irregular, leading to rough surfaces of these long bones. Then the bone becomes very much enlarged, almost twice to its normal size. Okay, means from the normal size, it may be almost double. And along with that, the respiratory problem, the lung lesions are also there, pneumonic changes and all these inflammatory concerns on the lungs and all. And along with this, one more condition is also that sometimes presence of the heartworms is also very common in such cases, dirofilariaemitis and the heartworms. So that is also used to be present. And in these conditions, so along with this respiratory problem disturbances of that very particular dog, for example, then it is showing some, this new bone formation just beneath the periosteum of the long bones also like. So that condition is known as pulmonary osteoarthropathy. Okay. So these are some of the these pictures and these reports shown that the dog was having respiratory problem. Okay, and even some of this heart problem also, and when it has been this check and this gone through properly, proper examination and all, so the long bones, the limbs and all this, and they were showing much and just enlarged and thickening and all, and with new bony tissue formation just beneath the periosteum like this, and the lungs was also very much affected, showing pneumonic changes, and the heartworms were also there inside these lungs and this heart and the heartworms, the dirofilariaemitis and all this, right? So the last part, this I will take in the next class, because this is another important course so far, and it will take some little bit more time. That's why I will just finish up this musculoskeletal system in the next class, and that is the fracture, bone fracture and repair. As of course we have already learned about the this healing and all these things. So in case of this bone fracture, what are the conditions leading to bone fracture and the different type of these fractures, and how it takes up the healing, the repairment of the bone fractures and all these things. So these things I'll take up in the next class. Okay, so that